Hi, I'm Carly Johnson.
And I'm Brook Ross.
And we're graduate students in the Marriage and Family Therapy Program at the University of Central Oklahoma. And we're here to talk to you today about social skills training and how you can use it to help combat children and adolescents with antisocial behavior. So just a brief overview about what antisocial behavior is and how it affects society at large is conduct disorders, school behavior problems, and other antisocial behavior problems are some of the most common reasons why children and adolescents are referred to school psychologists and clinicians. Between 4 and 6 million children in the United States are diagnosed with some sort of conduct disorder, oppositional defiance disorder, or just antisocial behavior in the United States on a given year. And it's a serious clinical and social problem because it can escalate into further behaviors in adults that can be a danger to society. The main thing is to catch antisocial behavior before it is actually diagnosed as oppositional defiant disorder or conduct disorder, so that you can actually treat the behaviors before they start. So, like I said, one of the two main diagnoses that occur with antisocial behavior are conduct disorder and oppositional defiance disorder. Conduct disorder is it is a repeated pattern within the past 12 months of the diagnosis of aggression to people and animals, deceitfulness and theft, destruction of property, and violation of serious rules. So, examples of aggression of property and would be vandalism, arson, stealing things out of yards, things like that. Aggression to people and animals would be maybe hitting the family dog, starting bullying at school, starting fights at school, stealing with a dangerous weapon. Deceitfulness and theft would be lying, stealing, both shoplifting, and then maybe overtly stealing something. And then serious violation of rules would be staying out late, repeatedly past the parents' curfew. This wouldn't just be a child who maybe once or twice snuck out to go to a party. It would also be running away for several days and then truancy from school on a regular basis. So these are things to look out for if you're a parent, a teacher, or another trainer, clinician, for things for antisocial behavior that deals with conduct disorder.
Another disorder is oppositional defiant disorder. This is a disorder where the individual has many issues with authority figures. They have a pattern of angriness or irritability. They're argumentative and they're defiant in their behaviors. They're also vindictive, and this is lasting more than 6 months with anyone other than a sibling. So Carly mentioned earlier covert and overt. These are different kinds of behavior patterns. One that I'm going to talk about is an overt behavior. This is something that is obvious and that you can see. Some examples is verbal abuse, bullying or hitting, aggression towards siblings, peers, parents, teachers, or other adults, aggression towards animals, stealing or confronting a victim, and forced sexual activity.
So those are overt antisocial behaviors that are going to be easy for you to see as a parent or a teacher or someone significant in the child and adolescent's life, because, as Brooke said, they're overt. It's pretty obvious when someone is hitting somebody or something like that. But there are also covert antisocial behaviors, which are a little bit harder to see, so you really need to pay attention in the child or adolescent's life if you feel like something's a little bit off. So examples of covert antisocial behavior include non-compliance, sneaking around, lying, secretly destroying someone else's property. So maybe that you hear that there have been several yards or properties in your neighborhood that have gotten damaged, but you didn't actually see your child or adolescent do it, or shoplifting. A child or adolescent who is showing antisocial behaviors can either be more covert, they can either be more overt, or they can have a mixture of the two. Often you'll see that maybe males have more covert or overt antisocial behaviors, where they're going to be more into fighting, bullying, things like that, and girls maybe more into the covert antisocial behaviors as far as the lying and the shoplifting. So there are some risk factors to look for if you are worried that your child or adolescent may have antisocial behaviors. Family characteristics are a big risk factor. It certainly isn't certain that a child has antisocial behaviors if they come from a family that has these risk factors, but it's something to look for. Those risk factors include parental history of antisocial behaviors. So as a parent, if you're self-aware enough to know that you struggled with this as a child, or if the teacher notices that the parent also struggles with this, that can be a risk factor in itself because these children have learned those behaviors. Parental drug and alcohol abuse can also contribute to antisocial behaviors. Having a chaotic or unstable home life, absencing of good parenting skills, coercive or corporal punishment. So if you are a teacher or a family member and you know that the parents of the child use corporal punishment, that might be something to look for. Parental disruption due to divorce, death, or other separation. So if you are going through one of these things and you start seeing your child to have some of these behaviors, it's important that you get help before they turn into a more serious diagnosis. Parental psychiatric disorder, especially maternal depression, and economic stress due to poverty. So all of those are very big familial environmental risk factors. There's also some others that you need to be aware of if you are a parent or a teacher and you're worried about your child. Heavy exposure to violence through TV or video games increases the likelihood that a child will have antisocial behaviors, especially if they're in an environment where those behaviors are going on in real life. For example, if you're playing a video game where it is gang-centered and there's a lot of violence through that video game, and you also live in a gang-filled neighborhood where you see those behaviors acted out in real life, your child or adolescent is at higher risk for antisocial behaviors and for those behaviors that he sees in the video game to model. And then also peer influence. So if you, your child or adolescent has friends that also have these antisocial behaviors, they might start to explain some of these behaviors themselves. So that's also important to watch out for your child or adolescent's peer group. There are some genetic and neurobiological issues as well. So if you have a child or adolescent that has antisocial behaviors and doesn't fall into any of the other risk factors, you may look at these genetic or neurobiological behaviors and genetic risk factors to see if that's the reason why your child has these behaviors.
So now that you have the background of antisocial behavior and what it is, we're going to go into social skills training and what all goes into that. It's important to know kind of the theories that are the framework for social skills training. Social learning theory is a huge theory that's a part of this framework. Another one that we thought was important in the research supports is attachment theory, because it's important that children have healthy attachments and know what a healthy attachment is. And sometimes when these children have antisocial behaviors, they could have attachment issues. And then the other one is an ecological model. And this model is great for psychoeducation when working with parents, because you can show them that the negative and positive sides of parenting and how to help children and positively connote them when they're doing positive behaviors.
So I'm going to just do a brief overview about what social skills training is. So there are several different models for social skills training. One of them, and this is the one that we're going to use in our modeling, is the prepare curriculum. And then, like I said, there's lots of different ones. There's also the Pride team put on by Oklahoma State University. But just in general, social skills training is what it sounds like. It is the direct teaching of social skills. It's been found to be highly successful in lots of different settings and with lots of different children. It's successful with highly aggressive children and adolescents, and then children who may have ADHD or autism, antisocial behaviors, delinquents. And because it's used correctly with so many different types of children, it can be used in a variety of settings as well. So So you might find it in schools, you might find it in juvenile delinquent facilities, and then you might also find it in private therapeutic settings. So even though there are different models for social skills training, many of them have the same skills that they use. So it's important for when you're researching social skills training settings that they have these components incorporated into their model, or it's probably not the best social skills training for you to take your child or adolescent to. So social skills training usually incorporates the following components. So skill identification. This is identifying which skill is going to be taught and what that means in a variety of settings. Modeling, so it's important for the trainer and clinician to model the skill that they're showing. So you want to make sure that you have very trained professionals doing the social skills training. You don't want to have somebody who doesn't know how to model the skills that they're teaching. Role playing. It's really important to have this component in your social skills training because this allows the adolescents and children to practice the social skill that they're being taught in a safe setting. And feedback. This is done off of the role playing. This would be where the trainer and clinician helps model the behavior for the child. So they'll go through the role play and the clinician will say, this is what you did really great and this is what we need to work on. And then transfer of training. So this is transferring the training from the trainer itself to the parent. So this includes parent classes and training the parents on what to look for so that when the child and the adolescent goes home, they are able to practice the behaviors that they've learned and that the parent is able to give feedback in those settings as well. So here are just some brief steps for the social skills training. This is what each session should follow. Each session is going to be a little bit different depending on the skill that you're teaching and then also the adolescents that you have in there. But the first thing you want to do is define the skill. This is going to look different depending on whether you have children or adolescents because there's going to be more basic skills taught for children than it is for adolescents. But it's to make sure that people are on the same page, especially when it's more of an abstract skill, especially in adolescents. Talking about peer pressure, which we're going to model later, is a lot different for an adolescent to define than just listening. So it's getting everybody on the same page of this skill to be taught. There's modeling the skill. So research has shown that modeling is a really effective and reliable technique for learning new behaviors. As Brett mentioned, this is the social learning. So this could be that you yourself as the trainer or clinician model the behavior, and it can also be that you bring in another staff member to help you model that as well. You also want to establish the training need. So you want to put adolescents together that maybe have the same skill needs. You don't want to teach an adolescent a skill that they don't need or fail to teach them one that they do need. So using assessments and observations from the parents, teachers, anyone important in the kid's life, and then also the child themselves to figure out what exactly they need to learn. You'll select a role player, and we'll show you how to do this later in the video, but each member of the group will need to participate in the role play to give them a chance and an opportunity, but the trainer may need to pick who goes first. Often these kids don't want to be here in social skills training, so they're not going to necessarily volunteer, so you may have to help choose. And then you're going to set up the role play. So you want to give it a real life situation and you want to explain exactly what the situation is for the children so they can do an accurate role play. Then you're actually going to conduct the role play. So you're going to want to act out the situation and the skill that you're wanting to teach. And then finally, you're going to provide performance feedback on that particular role play. And you will do this for each child until everybody in the skill group has completed the role play. And then you'll want to assign skill homework. So not only do the adolescents and children work on the skill in social skills training, they need to try it out in real life settings. So you'll want to help them kind of describe again this skill, describe where they're going to use it in real life settings, help the parents and teachers create those situations for where they can practice it, and have an opportunity for the children to write down, did I do well in this situation? What could I have worked on? And then you'll want to follow up on that homework at the next session. So that's just briefly what social skills training is and the steps that you'll want to follow. Like I said, there's lots of different models for social skills training, but each of them need to incorporate in somewhere, somehow, those components that we just discussed.
So now you may be thinking, what are different social skills that need to be learned? For people who have all their social cues, you might not realize that it's hard for some people to know how to apologize or to say no or to effectively listen and have a conversation with somebody. So for young children, some examples of a social skills training would be apologizing and learn the appropriate ways to apologize to somebody. Another one might be listening skills, and there are many different types of listening skills that you would need to go over. And then another one is just starting a conversation. It might be really hard for some children to know how to go up to someone, to say hi, to introduce themselves, and to start a conversation. The next group of children will be our older children that aren't quite adolescents. We like to call them the middle school years, and we know middle schoolers, 6th through about 8th grade, they're in those awkward teen years anyways. But so sometimes they'll need to know how to respond to teasing, using self-control, and asking permission. And then with adolescents, these are going to be the harder skills to learn, but it's how to deal with peer pressure, responding to failure, and then dealing with embarrassment. And those are just a few examples of many different types of skill training sets that you would need to go over.
Like I said earlier, it really depends on the group, the skills that your groups need. For example, if you are doing a social skills training in a juvenile detention center where people have been in that detention center for having very overt acts of antisocial behavior such as arson, bullying, fighting, forced sexual activity, you're going to have to deal with some of those harder social skills training. Whereas if you are doing this in a school setting, for people who maybe just need to learn appropriate boundaries, learn how to start a conversation, things like that. So you'll need to make sure that you select the skills that your social skills training needs. So we are going to do a couple of role plays and modeling of what you might see in a social skills training group from each of those skills that Brooke discussed. So you can also do role playing, and you can also do fun activities as well. So we're going to do a couple of both, but this first one is going to be a listening activity that you might do with a young child.
So this specific listening activity, they're going to try to learn how to capture and recall certain things, like out of a paragraph, or if they're sitting in school and the teacher is lecturing and they're having a hard time recalling what the teacher is saying. So for this activity, I'm going to read a few paragraphs, and then I'm going to ask a couple questions. Carly, you can have a pen and paper, and I want you to write down as many notes as you possibly can. And then once you get done with those notes, I'm going to ask you a series of questions and see if you can recall the important things out of the paragraphs.
Okay.
Okay, are you ready, Carly?
Yes.
Okay. RAI Studios needs extras of all ages for the movie Golden Fields, which is being filmed here throughout the month of October. If you are interested, be among the first 100 people to arrive at the parking lot behind Riley's Grocery Store at the corner of Juniper Street and 10th Avenue tomorrow at 7 a.m. Shooting will last through the day, and every extra chosen will be paid a flat fee of $150. Children between 12 and 18 must bring signed parental permission addressed to the studio, and children under 12 must be accompanied by an adult. All right, Carly, I'll give you 10 seconds to finish your notes, and then I'm going to read the next paragraph. Okay. A free session will explain the benefits of the ACME Computer Camp, a summer day camp for children in grades 4 through 8. Who want to learn about computers and 5 of the most popular software programs currently being used in homes and schools. Camp classes meet at 8 a.m. to 1:30 p.m., and all materials and equipment are provided. Anyone can attend the introductory session at 8 p.m., Wednesday, April 22nd, in the Sunset Room of the Dobbs Hotel, 3030 Circle Drive. For more information, call 689 7000. All right, Carla, I'll give you about 10 seconds and I'll read the last paragraph. Okay. My house is at 3946 Taylor Ridge Road. To get there, walk west 4 blocks on Center Drive until you get to the high school. Turn left and go up the hill on Harvard Street. At the top of the hill, after the stop sign, Harvard Street turns into Taylor Ridge Road. Keep going south until you come to the first side street to the right. My house is the 6th one on the right. Okay, are you done, Carly?
Yes.
I just want to say, first off, that you did such a good job. You listened so well the whole time and you were writing great notes, and I can tell you were really interested.
Thank you.
Okay, so for the first one, I'm going to ask you a series of questions and let's see if you can answer them, okay?
Okay.
What is the name of the movie?
Golden Fields.
That's right. What studio is making the movie?
I think it was at the beginning and it was hard for me to remember, but I think it's RAI or RIA Studios.
That's great, Carly. Good job. What will the extras, how will the extras be chosen?
It didn't necessarily say, but it said that you had to be one of the first 100 people and then they would choose out of those.
Wow, Carly, you really listened. What is the pay to get in?
I think $100.
Good job. And what special instructions were given for children?
You had to be with a parent if you were under a certain age. I couldn't remember exactly which one. And then if you were under 18, you had to have signed permission.
Good job, Carly. You really listened. So you did great for that first one. Do you feel comfortable with that one?
Yeah, there were a couple of stuff that I didn't remember, but I think you did good.
All right, well, let's see if you remembered when we read the second paragraph. What is the price of the introductory session?
I think it's free.
Yeah. And what is the price of the camp?
I never could get that. I just heard the free session. I don't know if it actually said the price of the camp.
Yeah, that's okay. And what is the purpose of the session?
It's to talk about learning about the computer softwares.
Yeah, good job. And who is the camp for?
It's for children in grade school.
Yeah, okay. And how many software programs are taught at the camp?
I didn't catch that part.
Well, that's okay. You did really good on the first part. And where is the session being held at?
In a hotel, the Dogs Hotel.
Okay, good job. Very good. All right, now let's go over the last one. Is that okay?
Uh-huh.
All right. How many blocks do you walk on Center Drive?
4.
Good job. And where do you turn off Center Drive?
On Harvard Street.
Okay. And what landmark is at the corner of Center Drive and Harvard Street?
The high school.
Good job. And where does Harvard Street turn into Taylor Ridge Road?
I wrote down after the stop sign.
Okay. And what is the address on Taylor Ridge Road?
3943 Taylor Ridge Road.
I am so impressed with you, Carly. Now, how do you feel about this skill?
I feel like I'm pretty good at listening.
Okay.
It's kind of hard sometimes in school when I have more things going around than we do here.
Okay.
But it was a good skill for me to learn.
Okay, so maybe for our next skill, we'll learn how to listen with other kids around and how to kind of tune out some of the outside noise. Okay. All right, so that would be a listening skill on how to recall long lectures when you're sitting in class. And obviously when it's one in person, it's going to be easier to listen. So the next thing we would do is I would want to introduce this to a group setting with other children and where there's going to be other kids moving around, possibly talking, and it would be easier for Carly to get distracted.
So the next one we're going to do is responding to teasing. So this is a skill really that you can use through children, adolescents, and middle school years because it's really important for kids to learn the difference, how to respond to teasing, but also are they really being mean-spirited in their teasing or are they just poking fun? So in this skill, we're going to talk about different ways that you can decide if you're being teased and how to respond to it. And then we're going to talk about different situations where you might be teased and then do a role play to decide how appropriately to respond to the teasing. So Brooke, the first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna go through the steps on how to respond to teasing. What do you think being teased means?
making fun of me.
Can they do it in front of you? Can they do it to your friends behind your back? Does it matter?
I think it would hurt my feelings more if they did it to my face.
If you knew about it. Okay, so I'm going to talk about some of the steps we're going to do when you feel like you may be being teased.
Okay.
So step one is really deciding, are you being teased? So are they making jokes? Are they whispering? Are they just poking fun at you? Can you think of a situation where you may feel like you're being teased, but your friends are really just trying to have a good time?
Maybe when we're in class and we're reading and I accidentally mess up my lines.
Mm-hmm. And they're just having fun. The difference is maybe they're doing it in front of you. Mm-hmm. They're laughing with you, not at you. Mm-hmm. And you actually think it's kind of funny as well.
Okay.
So if you really think that you are being teased, so it is mean-spirited, they're making fun of you and your feelings are hurt, the second step is to decide how you're going to deal with that.
I would hit them.
So that's probably not the best way to deal with teasing. I know that when you get teased, you're angry, you're embarrassed, you want to lash out. There's a couple of things that you can do. You can make a joke about it yourself, like using the example of they're making fun of you for messing up your line. You can laugh it off and say, you know, haha, yeah, I did mess that up. It sounded funny.
Mm-hmm.
Or you can just ignore it. Mm-hmm. A lot of times they're not going to continue teasing you if they're not getting a reaction out of you. You can also confront them about it. You can say that you don't like being teased, especially if it's your friends. They may not realize that it hurts your feelings. So you need to think about the different ways that you could respond. And then step three is choose the best way and then actually do it.
Okay.
So when possible, you want to avoid ways that are going to be aggressive. So like you said, maybe hitting somebody is not the best way because that'll make the situation worse.
Okay.
You also don't want to create a situation where you can get teased more or that you tease them. So maybe the best way to respond to teasing is not to tease them back.
Okay.
So we're going to go through some different ways where you might find teasing in three different settings. So school, you already mentioned maybe getting made fun of for messing up a line, but you could also, maybe a classmate comments on you volunteering to stay after class and they call you a brown noser or a teacher's pet.
Mm-hmm.
So what do you think maybe a way for you to respond to that would be?
I think I would just ignore it because I know I'm there for the right reasons and maybe I just need help with something and that's okay if they think that about me.
Absolutely. I think that's a great way to respond. They're probably not going to keep on teasing you, and they're probably a little bit jealous that they're not getting to stay after with the teacher as well. So maybe you're with your friends, and your friend is teasing you about your new boyfriend and is making fun of him and making jokes about him. What do you think a way would be to respond to that?
I don't think I could ignore that. And so I would probably need to get away from the situation for a little bit to kind of calm down. But then eventually I think I would want to have a conversation with her and tell her that that hurts my feelings and I don't like how she talks about him that way.
I think that's a great way to respond in that situation. So your feelings might be hurt. You might be a little bit angry in that moment. So taking the time to calm down and then go talk to her afterwards about, you know, this is my boyfriend. I really like him and he's going to be around. So it hurts my feelings whenever you fun of him is a great way to respond to that situation. Another group at home maybe would be your siblings are teasing you about a new haircut, and I actually want to act this one out for you.
Okay.
So I'm going to be your sibling and I'm going to tease you about your new haircut, and I want you to in the moment respond about how you really would in that situation.
Okay.
So we're going to start the role play.
Okay.
Oh my gosh, Brooke, your hair. Did you just get it cut? It looks a little bit interesting.
Yeah, you don't like it?
No, it looks funny. It doesn't look good on you.
Why? That's not very nice.
Well, you know what they say about redheads. I don't know. I think you should dye your hair. I don't think it looks great.
But Carly, I can't dye my hair. This is just my natural hair.
Oh. Is there any way you can fix it where it doesn't look so funny?
Carly, you're really starting to hurt my feelings.
Okay, I don't mean to hurt your feelings. I'm just trying to help.
You're not helping.
Okay.
I like my hair the way it is. What if I told you your hair was ugly?
I wouldn't like that.
Okay.
Well, I'm sorry. I was just trying to help, and I won't tease you anymore.
Thank you.
So those are just some ways that you can model teasing and how to help a child or adolescent go through those different situations that they might go through. It may seem silly when you're doing it, but obviously these kids don't have some of those skills that maybe a child or adolescent typically has. So going through these skills in these different situations is really great for kids who have some of these antisocial behaviors. So the next one we're going to go through is going to be peer pressure. And this one's going to be a little bit more difficult just because you're going to be dealing with adolescents and there are so many different ways to talk about peer pressure. So the first thing you're going to want to do is kind of talk about peer pressure and what that means in some of the situations that an adolescent might experience peer pressure. So Brooke, what are some ways and situations that you think you might experience peer pressure? And what do you think peer pressure is?
I think maybe when, like, I'm hanging out after school with some of my friends and stuff, and maybe someone decides to smoke a cigarette or something like that in front of me, and they offer it to me.
Mm-hmm. And they repeatedly ask you to do it,
yeah.
Right? They don't say, they don't really accept your no.
No, but everyone else is doing it.
Mm-hmm. And it makes you feel bad for saying no, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to talk about some different ways that you can respond to peer pressure.
Okay.
And we're going to actually model some of them in a specific situation that you're probably going to come up with if you haven't already.
Okay.
So one, we're going to call it the repeat.
Okay.
So this is keep repeating your no.
Okay.
So this would be, you know, if you say, no, I don't want to smoke, they keep saying, well, Brooke, everybody does it. Here, have one. Just try it. It's not a big deal. Mm-hmm. You're going to just keep saying no until they get tired of it.
Okay.
The compromise is this would be here, have some alcohol. And you say, I don't want any, but I'll go get a soda with you.
Okay.
So kind of. Maybe they think it's awkward that you're not drinking when everyone mm-hmm. else is, and so you're going to go do something that you feel comfortable with and kind of negate that peer pressure.
Okay.
The last one is the reason. Mm-hmm. So maybe they just don't understand why you're not doing what you're doing. Mm-hmm. So they're going to continue to ask you smoking, like, do you want to smoke? Why aren't you smoking? Everybody does it. And you're going to say, well, I don't want to smoke because I'm in track, and that's mm-hmm. going to, I want to qualify for the state meet. I don't think it's healthy and it's not going to be good for my running. And they'll probably be like, oh, okay, because that's a good reason for them.
Okay.
So we're going to model these three in a situation where you're at a party and someone's trying to get you to drink.
Okay.
So I'm going to be the friend who is pressuring you.
Okay.
And you're going to practice each of these reasons or skills for going through not going into peer pressure. So the first one is remember the repeat.
Okay.
So here, Brooke, have a beer.
No thanks, I don't want any.
Are you sure? Everyone's doing it, we have plenty.
No thanks, I don't want any.
Come on, you don't wanna try a beer? Everyone's trying it.
No thanks, I really don't want any.
So that's a very good example. People are just gonna continue to ask and ask and ask, mm-hmm. but if you keep saying no mm-hmm. and staying firm, then eventually they're gonna get tired of it.
Okay.
So the next one is we're going to be the compromise. So thinking of something else that maybe you can do with them to have some fun, but that isn't breaking the rules.
Okay.
So come on, Brooke. Come on. Let's try this rum and Coke.
No thanks, but I'll just have a Coke.
Okay, I'll go get you one.
Thank you.
So again, like I said, they may feel like they're uncomfortable that you're not drinking when everyone else is.
Mm-hmm.
So even just having a soda in your hand might make them feel a little bit more uncomfortable and to stop peer pressuring you.
Okay.
So the last one is going to be the reason. So this would be the reason why you're not.
Okay.
So here, Brooke, come have a beer with me.
No thanks. If I get caught, my parents will kill me.
Oh, that's true. Mine will probably get mad at me, but they're out of town, so I don't really care.
Oh, you're lucky. Mine would never go out of town, and they would really kill me.
So that's good. That's another
really great way to resist peer pressure. You're relating to them. They know that your parents will probably kill you. It's a good excuse because most adolescents are very afraid of their parents. So that's a really great job.
So those are just some skills that you would practice going through how to combat peer pressure. You'd want to make sure that you did it in a variety of situations, not just at a party. Maybe find some ways at school or sit at home. But just modeling that behavior, talking with the adolescents, and talking about different ways that they can practice it in real life is really going to make your social skills training successful. And those are just three ways or skills that we talked about in social skills training. As Brooke said, there's many different social skills that you can work on. And they may not just take one session. They may not be as easy as we just did. So really working with those adolescents and going on their pace and what they need to learn is really important.
And something to remember when you're doing a group setting is maybe you have one child or adolescent who isn't learning the skill as fast as the other children in the group. It's okay to pull them out of group and do some individual booster sessions in between so they can, they might just need some more time learning that skill.
You also may have to work with the parents. Mm-hmm. So if the child is doing really well in social skills training, and when they come back, they haven't been doing their homework, they haven't been doing well in the home or the school, you may have to schedule a meeting with the parents and the teachers to say, look, I really need these behaviors enforced that they're learning in social skills training. Also, if the family has those risk factors, you may have to work with the parents or get them referred to another therapist or clinician to get some of their behaviors worked out, especially if they have antisocial behaviors themselves.
So some things to remember as a trainer putting on the social skills training is just remember the process. You want to teach, practice, give feedback, and revise. You want to reinforce patience, reinforce positive behavior. And Carly did a great job as reflecting. So everything that I said, she reflected what I said, and then also added some more ways to help me get through that those teasing things that I was taught that we were doing. Be sure to inform adolescents on consequences of negative behavior, and you want to promote graduate practices in real life situations.
If you are a teacher or a parent who is struggling having a child or adolescent with antisocial behavior, there are some great resources in the community to help you. So the Oklahoma Parent Center is a website that has a list of all sorts of different resources for parents and teachers who may have a child with antisocial behavior or autism or ADHD, any behavior that might require intervention with social skills training. There's also Sensational Kids. They put on great social skills training. And then the Center for Social Success. So if you are struggling and don't know where to turn, these are three great resources. They're just three of many. So if I would encourage anyone who has trouble with a kid with antisocial behavior to really get them into social skills training early so that you can help negate some of these behaviors and they can have a successful adolescence and adulthood.
So that is social skills training for antisocial youth. We hope you've learned a few things and we've pointed you in a direction to get help. Thank you.